Okay, everybody, welcome to the second talk of the afternoon session. Next to me is Michael Koenig. Wait. Michael Koenig from Blue Yonder, one of the community partners of PyCon.de. He will talk about database access. So we just talked about ingestion, now it's access. Give him a warm hand. The stage is yours.
Thanks, guys, for attending and giving me a warm welcome. I will talk today about TurboDBC, which is turbocharging your database access for data scientists. And before I do that, I'll just give you a general introduction to databases at Python. There's PEP249. It's a Python enhancement proposal. It's pretty old. And it's widely adopted by most database modules that you may find for Python. And with this, database code looks the same basically everywhere. You have your database module. You import a connect function. You call the connect function to get a connection with some arguments that depend on a module. With your connection object, you can get a cursor object. And a cursor object is what you do your actual workload on. So you call execute with some query. You can use the fetch all method to get an iterable of iterable over the results. So in this case, it could be a list of lists, where the inner lists would be individual rows in your database. If you want to send in data to the database, PEP249 has the execute many function. You also pass in a query, but then a list of parameters, or an iterable of parameters, where within the iterable you have another iterable that represents individual parameter sets. So this is how you use databases with Python, and that's the theory. In practice, you have many different databases. For example, a database by vendor A, which may use a database that stores data in a row-wise fashion, so rows in a contiguous memory range. And this database vendor kindly offers a database module for Python that will internally do some I/O. Using some C API or using Python directly or async I/O or whatever you may think of. And once this I/O is done, you will have a translation layer that breaks up individual values that are transferred from the database into individual Python objects. That would be those rounded thingies that you see at the bottom. And those Python objects would be the ones that you get when you call cursor fetch all. Now, of course, you don't only have one database, you have multiple databases. So you may have a columnar database, which stores columns in a contiguous fashion. And of course, database vendor B is also nice and provides a database module B for Python that you can use in just the exactly same way with cursor fetch all. So that's the ideal situation. But sadly, we don't live in an ideal world. And the reason behind this is that it takes lots of love to create a database driver that performs well. So this plot is obviously very scientific and not at all fabricated. I could have taken different axes like feature completeness over effort or whatever. I just want to illustrate that it takes a lot of time to get a database driver right. So now you're database vendor A and say, I have this nice Python community. I want to be accessible for them. But I also have other communities. I have the Rust community. I have people doing Java, people doing C++. And if I want to be nice to everyone, I basically have a team of 200 developers just developing database drivers. And this is not a new problem. And this is why there's a standard for that. That's ODBC. And often database providers just implement an ODBC driver and say, OK, this is standard. You can use the standard for any language. So in practice, you have various databases, for example, Postgres, MySQL, MariaDB. They all ship ODBC drivers. These ODBC drivers comply with the ODBC API. It's kind of an open standard for database connectivity. And it tells database vendors how their drivers should look like. But it also tells application developers how these drivers can be used. And so you can implement ODBC modules for Python, for C++, any language you like. You can develop an ODBC module and implement it into your application. So for example, Microsoft Excel has support for ODBC data sources. And so in principle, all those languages and applications can talk to any database over the same API. So scrolling back a few years, we at Blue Yonder use a fairly exotic database. It's called Accessor. It's really fast, and it's our powerhouse for analytical queries. And Accessor did not have a native Python driver. So all we had was an ODBC driver that we could use. And when we migrated from C++ to handle our machine learning to Python, this was a problem. And I didn't understand the problem at first because I was more like a C++ guy. But developers complained about the performance of databases on Python. And I just couldn't get it because it was very, very fast in my C++ thing that I had. And so I made a few measurements. So those benchmarks are from 2015. You don't have to understand this plot in detail. On the y-axis, you see basically the number of rows that you can read from the database per second. On the horizontal axis, you see the size of the result set. You see a few various database sizes in there. And you see two lines. The blue line is the performance that we had with PyODBC in Python. And the red line was the performance I was seeing from C++ with a custom ODBC module. Granted, the C++ thing did not output Python objects, but just C++ thingies. But it was tremendously faster than PyODBC, so it was like a factor of 30. And this got me thinking, so what is taking up all the time? Because I know it can be fast, and it shouldn't be that hard to create a Python driver, or can it? Okay, so now let me give you an introduction of the basics of ODBC, and I've called this section SlowDBC and TurboDBC. SlowDBC because I don't want to blame any particular ODBC module that's out there. They're all the same, and also to indicate that I will simplify what's coming quite a bit. Okay, so let's go back to our picture where we have two databases, and those databases now supply ODBC drivers. And the slow DBC approach would be to have a core buffer and to have this core buffer exactly large enough to hold a single row of your result set. That's very convenient because the ODBC API makes this very easy and accessible. So if you want to get started quickly, you do just that. Okay, then you need to add some logic to create the data in the internal core buffer into something that complies with PEP249, so you can call fetch all. Okay, how would a data flow look like? Now imagine we have a column on our columnar database that consists of 64-bit integers. So we have two values in there. Then SlowDBC would ask the database for a value. The ODBC driver would transport this into the core buffer, where it would stay until it's converted. And at some point, this 64-bit binary integer data will be transferred into a Python object, for example, a long. Okay, now I'm done with my first row. I would repeat the process for the other columns, obviously, but I still have a second row. And again, the ODBC driver would ask the database, please give me the next row, and would then painstakingly convert the 64-bit integer into a Python object, adding pointers, adding reference counts, managing all the stuff, probably using the GIL. That's very time-consuming. Okay, and the same basically happens if I go the reverse way. I will spare you the animation here, so there's none. But it basically, you need to transfer individual Python objects back into a binary representation that ODBC can work on, and then transfer this back line by line, if you use the ODBC API in a very simple way. So we have two contributors that are basically obvious that make things slow. The first one is doing everything line by line, parameter set by parameter set, row by row, whatever you may call it. And the second thing is converting binary data that is already in a format that every CPU understands into Python objects. Okay, and this is basically where I decided that I could build a new ODBC module. And this is what I did with TurboDBC. It's available on GitHub since about 2 years. It supports Python 2.7, Python 3.4, 3.5, 3.6. It runs on Windows, OS X, and Linux. And it's available on PyPI and also on Conda. And let me explain the key differences. So again, we go back to the picture where we have two databases and two ODBC drivers. The first key difference is I don't use any row-wise operations. So I have a core buffer that consists of columnar data structures, just as I might have it on a columnar database. And this basically gives me the freedom to use batches, not row-wise operations, but batches of rows, 100,000 rows, a million rows. Okay, then of course I want to be compliant to PEP249, so there's no way around providing an interface that will convert the values from my core buffer into Python objects. But of course we all know data structures that are well suited to handle binary content, and that would be NumPy arrays. So I've added another front end that uses the same core buffer and basically returns columnar NumPy arrays or masked NumPy arrays. And I make these accessible conveniently with a new API extension that I called fetch all NumPy. And it's not the last columnar data structure that is well known. You may have attended a talk by Uwe Korn yesterday, and he taught us about Apache Arrow. So I was very happy when Uwe contributed an Arrow front end that uses the same core buffer technology. So it's basically just another optional plugin that is put on top of the same buffer. And so instead of Python objects, you can now also get an Arrow table that contains all the data in a columnar fashion. Now let's have a look at what happens with the two in64 values that I've stored on my database. TurboDBC will do one request to the database and fetch all of them into the core buffer. Okay, so there's only one round trip to the database, not millions of round trip for a million rows, but maybe one or two to get my batch. And now I export this to Arrow. And it's also just moving around those integers. So it's a simple copy operation. There's no conversion necessary at all, because a 64-bit integer is a 64-bit integer no matter where it's stored, on a database, in a buffer, or in Arrow or in NumPy. To be more specific how it looks like in code, I assume that we have a cursor where we have already executed a query. So using cursor fetch all NumPy, I would get a data object. The data object is indeed an ordered dictionary with pairs of column names and masked arrays of binary NumPy data. And if I want to get this into a data frame, which is eventually what most data scientists will be interested in, I can just call the pandas data frame constructor with the exact input that I get out. So very easy. Let's have a look at the Arrow front end. It's similarly easy. I just call fetch all Arrow on the cursor. I will get a data object that is a PyArrow table. It will tell me I have a column in there with 64-bit integers, and I can just call a toPandas function that is kindly provided by Arrow, and I will have a pandas data frame with no conversion at all. So it's very easy. Okay, so how do we do the reverse way? Of course, I need to be compliant with PEP249. So I've added a PEP249 backend that will accept generic Python objects. Okay, but now I have columnar output. I also want to have columnar input. So I've added support with another NumPy frontend. And instead of calling execute many, I added a new function, execute many columns, because the semantics are different. Execute many expects data in a row-wise fashion. Now I have data in a columnar fashion, and I want to note that with a new name. Okay, so I give in some NumPy arrays, some NumPy masked arrays, and those will be sent to the database. Similarly, for arrow, I also have columnar data. So I put this in the same execute many columns. So I can just pass this in. Again, let's have a look at the code. So I assume that we have a data frame at hand, which is, again, what most data scientists will be content with. We need a bit of logic to get the NumPy arrays out. So I need to iterate over the data frame and then extract the values from the resulting tuple. And then I just call cursor execute many columns with a query that has some parameters in there. And I just pass it in NumPy arrays. And similarly, if I have a look at the Apache arrow front end, I need to create an arrow table from this data frame. I do this using the from pandas method that arrow provides. I make sure to not preserve the index because this would add another column. I just call, again, execute many columns on my cursor with a query and this arrow table. And everything is then done for me. Okay, now I've presented you lots of ways how to get data into your database and data from your database. How does it compare with existing technology? And obviously, it won't quite match up to FPGA-supported power horses, but let's have a look. I have XSOL, that's true. Okay, so I made a few performance measurements, and I should mention I made all those measurements on my laptop that I'm also using for this presentation here. I used virtual machines and Docker containers for the measurements to pull up the databases. I didn't do any special database tweaking. I used them out of the box. I tried to use the latest software versions that I could find or get hold of for the VMs that I was using. I inserted or retrieved about 1 million rows with 20 columns each, where I made sure to mix in integers, floating points, timestamps, and strings. So it's about 250 bytes per row. And then I measured the best of five trials to get data from a database into a pandas data frame and vice versa from pandas data frame back into the database. Okay, and before I show you the results, let me just list a few factors that influences the actual performance so you don't expect any wonders. When you're dealing with a database, you basically have three components to the performance. The first one is the database needs to execute what you actually want. Then you have some communication overhead with your database, and then you need to translate the Python thingies to your communication layer. So that's the main three performance drivers. For the execution, this will depend on the database itself. It will depend on the SQL query that you are actually going to execute. It will depend on the hardware that you run it on the number of rows you are about to insert, on the data types that are in there. It may depend on the size of your table that you're inserting to. It may depend on index creation, constraints checks. It may depend on the load that you have on a database. So many things that can go horribly wrong. In the communication, you have, let's say, ODBC drivers, the settings for the ODBC driver, available bandwidth, how does your network look like, what kind of buffer have you configured, what kind of data types have you in there, how many columns do you have in a row. For the translation layer, it depends on the front end. Will I use PEP249, will I use Arrow, NumPy, whatever, on which hardware am I running this thing. There are lots of variables that I won't resolve in there, just to give you a clue on why this is difficult. And of course, I'm the developer of TurboDBC, so I know my way around TurboDBC pretty well, I guess. I'm not sure if I'm missing something with other database modules that I use, and I may have inadvertently implemented a bias in my benchmark just because I picked this data frame to database thing. Okay, so take the values that you see with a grain of salt. Okay, let's have a look at how TurboDBC fares for Microsoft SQL Server 2017, latest edition. On the horizontal thing, you see five different ways to access the database. The first one is PyODBC, which is the de facto standard for ODBC communication from Python. Then you see the three different TurboDBC front ends, and then PyTDS, which appears to be the most popular Python-only native thing to communicate with Microsoft SQL Server. On the horizontal axis, you see the read rates, and the colors indicate writing and reading, respectively. And you see there's not too much of a difference between PyODBC and TurboDBC when it comes to reading. That's probably because the ODBC driver does some internal caching, so it's not too important if you do this column by column or batch by batch. But it already falls way behind when you're trying to put data into your database. You see a tremendous speed up when you go to NumPy and Arrow, and both of these perform pretty well. And you see that the native thing in the form of PyTDS, it's way slower than the other methods. Okay, let's have a look at the next database. That would be PostgreSQL. And again, you see on the vertical axis many different ways to access the database. And as an example for a native driver, I've added PsychoPG2. I did not use AsyncPG because I wanted to execute all benchmarks in the same environment. And sadly, some of the modules that I used only have the Python 2.7 support. So I couldn't use AsyncPG in this case. Okay, what I can see is reading is very similar with all techniques. It's remarkable that PsychoPG is as fast as TurboDBC using NumPy and Arrow, even though PsychoPG does not have particular support for these binary data structures. The reason for this is that the Postgres ODBC driver that is open source is not the fastest one. So it does some caching with 100 rows each. And there's not too much you can do about the ODBC driver in this case. But when it comes to writing, it's at least possible to be faster than PsychoPG2. OK, and last but not least, I want to return to the Exasol database that I mentioned in the very beginning. And that was one of the major pain points. So again, on the vertical axis, you see six different methods to access the database. The first four of them you know. Then there's a new tool, it's Exasol WebSockets, which uses a JSON-based WebSocket protocol to send data over the internet. And there's Exasol SDK, which basically uses PyODBC, then through some evil magic hijacks the TCP connection, opens up a local web service, exports a CSV file of your data, puts the CSV file in compressed form over your network, where the database will use its highly tuned CSV import way to get data into the database. Okay, comparing PyODBC with TurboDBC, we see that using the plain PEP249 front end, TurboDBC beats PyODBC by a factor of about 4 or 5 for the specific benchmark I've set up. Writing is much faster, and we can get another factor of 2 or 3 just using NumPy and Arrow, basically eliminating the binary data to Python object conversion. Exasol WebSockets, again, is a native implementation. It's a bit faster than PyODBC in reading, but I couldn't get it to run with writing the data that I've picked. So this may need some improvement. And the Exasol SDK, which has seen lots of love by the database vendor, it fares pretty well, but it's not as well as the NumPy and Arrow support. Okay, coming to a summary. I hope I have motivated that TurboDBC can be an alternative to native database modules and other ODBC modules. I've shown you API extensions to the familiar PEP249 interface with fetch all NumPy, fetch all arrow, and execute main columns. And indeed, I would be happy if other native drivers would also pick similar API extensions as well, because it helps a lot to reduce the waste when it comes to getting data into a data frame. And last but not least, the mileage that you may get out of TurboDBC may vary on many factors, on your ODBC driver, on your database, but it's not very expensive to just try it out and give it a spin. And I would recommend that you do that for yourself, because I'm pretty sure you are biased to your problem that you want to solve, while I am not. And if you have some feedback or features or whatever you want to, just open an issue at GitHub, give me a star, follow me on Twitter to learn about the latest developments and get some PyCon DE pictures. And now I'm open for your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, for the talk. Any questions from the audience?
So can you tell me what would be with SQLite, so the performance of SQLite, because that's directly in the standard Python library. So if you convert a pandas data frame and put it in a SQLite database, you know how fast that is compared to that?
I'm sorry, I don't know, because I have not tested SQLite that. It's an oversight, and I would like to include it in my build chain. I haven't done it yet, so no numbers. Sorry.
Thanks.
What's your guess?
I have no guess. It's so hard from the ODBC drivers. You can have drivers that optimize most of the steps away for you to make it easy for ODBC application developers to get performance out of it. So if this is the case, then there won't be any speed up. If I can't make any reliable assumption. I just would have to test it.
Thanks, that was great. If you do want to try it out, but you don't really understand all that much about databases outside of copy-pasting code from Stack Overflow and like building applications, How would you go about trying this out versus just a standard Postgres?
Good thing you asked. There's a documentation section. I have TurboDBC at read the docs. And it has a section about databases. And I have to admit the ODBC stack is not the easiest one to get into, because you need the ODBC driver and you need an ODBC configuration. But in the database specific section, I have added some configuration that may get you started. And I've also added some background info on what this ODBC thing is about. So I hope that's a good starting point. If you fail to try it out with this, then please file a ticket so I can explain it better.
So the NumPy and Arrow extensions to the Python database API seem to be like a very sane way to use. Are there any plans to include them into the official standard from the Python database access?
That would be great. I've been too humble so far to propose that. So I guess if it gets more traction, then this would be something that I would consider doing, because I think it's really valuable, and we have learned yesterday that, in particular, the arrow thing may help to share data among different systems or even different languages. So it could even eliminate the need to get a fast ODBC driver available in, I don't know, Rust or whatever. So if we could just share the data. So it's something worth considering.
I suspect the answer is, I don't know, but what is your guess on what the current bottlenecks are when pulling data out of these common databases?
Okay, so for Exasol, I suspect that the bottleneck is basically I/O, so getting data over the network. I know for sure that the CSV export with the Exasol SDK uses zip compression, and I'm reasonably sure that the ODBC driver does not. So basically, I'm sending across the full enchilada of bytes even if I would only send in lots of zeros. So that would be something that could unlock another factor of, I don't know, 3 or 4.
What about for the less exotic databases like Postgres?
Well, it really depends. I mean, there's also alternative ODBC drivers for Postgres that are commercial in nature. I think DataDirect has something on offer. I don't know how these compare because, well, I didn't want to invest any money just to get performance values for a database that I don't usually use.
I have a related question. I wonder if we still would see a large improvement if there is a slow or more or less slow, comparable slow network in between. So what do you expect? If the server is not on your local computer but somewhere else on the network, would we still see a reasonable improvement?
I have made other benchmarks that I have not reproduced here, of course, with, let's say, more fully fledged databases being located not on my laptop but somewhere else in a computing center. I've seen even more speed up there. It basically depends on will your database driver do a lot of round trips or won't it do a lot of round trips. So there's latency involved. It depends on how large the overhead is for sending a package with the relevant data to the database. So it's very, very hard to estimate and make any trustworthy assumptions on that. So I would just give it a spin. It's always the best. If it works for you, that's great. If it doesn't work out of the box, there's ways to tweak TurboDBC by picking different buffer sizes or even by just turning on asynchronous I/O in the background. So there's ways to tune it, but the answer may eventually be that your native driver that you have is faster. But I've never seen it seen TurboDBC being slower than PyODBC, for example.
Any more questions? Going once, going twice, sold. Let's give another round of applause for Michael. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.